Hello everyone, I'm Wendell Jones and welcome to this edition of the program, Jones and Company. On this program, we examine national issues and we are getting set for the 41st observance of our independence as a country, the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. And we've done well in many, many areas. And there is also reason for concern in some areas. And today on our program, we are discussing our country, the Bahamas. And we have a fitting guest for our program today, the Minister of Foreign Affairs and Immigration, the Honorable Fred Mitchell, who is also the Member of Parliament for Fox Hill. He is our guest on the program today. Minister, welcome to the program.
Thank you very much. A pleasure being here.
Nice to have you, Gatrienius.
Thank you.
You look very cool in your attire here today.
It's the summer, Mr. Jones.
It's summer, summer. Yes.
It's gone native.
It's gone native. Minister, you're just back from the CARICOM meeting, the heads of government meeting of CARICOM, and so there are a number of issues I believe you can discuss today. But for starters, since we are celebrating the 41st anniversary of our country, what is the state of our country today?
I think it's generally good, and people have a great sense of the Bahamas and what it is. I think they're proud to be Bahamian and proud to be in this country. And so I wanted to start off by saying Happy Independence Day to all Bahamians. It's been a real honor to be around as a British subject before 1973. All the debates when I was in high school about whether the country could be independent or not, and then to actually see it, you know, standing between Cyril Stevenson and Eric Wilmot on the park in 1973, watching Sidney Poitier walk around the perimeter. And then I learned, I thought he was just putting on a performance because the crowd was cheering as he walked around the crowd, and he later told me that actually he was lost because he didn't know where he was going. So a lot of fond memories, and it's just been an interesting time, the difficulties notwithstanding.
Yeah, let me ask you, 41 years ago, I'm sure you didn't know where you would be today. Certainly you didn't know that you would be Minister of Foreign Affairs. When you assess how we have done politically in the country, what do you say?
I think we've done well. The thing that's good to me is that notwithstanding the differences between the sides, we're not shooting each other with guns. And I think that's a huge, huge example for everyone else as the way to do things. And Caribbean-wide, that's generally been the case. But we have had, you know, peaceful elections, changes of governments. We continue to have disagreements in politics, but largely it's been a peaceful exercise.
Godfrey?
Mr. Mitchell, I wrote a book called The New Caribbean, A Region in Transition. You mentioned earlier about growing up in the colonial era. Is there a new Caribbean?
I think so, in the sense that the younger generation, those people who are under 30, have a different sense of what is possible, and they want things done in quicker time, and can't understand the old ways. And that, I think, is refreshing, because at heart I'm a libertarian and, you know, anti-regulation, and so that's good. But as Ralph Gonzalez just said in a meeting, even when there's a revolution, it's still built on something which went before. And I was just talking to the people who started the immigration class. We've been fighting for 2 years to get this class started. We finally got it started today. And I look at all these eager young faces and I'm saying to them, you know, this is a country we're handing off to you. They're all in their early 20s. And they have this look of anxiousness, but the country actually belongs to them, and they're going to help to frame it. But what our responsibility is to say, this is how things were, this is how they are, this is how we're going to leave them to you. And we're the guardians of that, all of us.
When you look at what went on before and where we are now, I would say that, from my opinion, the successes of this region is embedded in the new governments of the region. What is your opinion?
Well, the governments certainly, but I think the people themselves. I mean, the people drive the governments. And, you know, I was, again, we went when we were in Antigua to see Lester Byrd. Lester Byrd is the former prime minister.
86 years old, isn't he?
76.
76.
He's not bedridden, but can't walk now because he's an operation on his back. But he just won a re-election again. He said this is his 8th election. He was telling the story of his having come to the Bahamas for the first time in 1959 as a friend of Tommy Robinson. They went to university together. And one of the great regrets he has is that he was unable to come to Tommy's funeral because he was ill. But he was saying how he was at Haynes Oval watching a cricket match. And in the middle of the match, he saw people scrambling across the field and running. And he asked, well, what's going on here? And it was Haitians running from the police. So there was some kind of, and I thought to myself, well, here I am now, the immigration minister, 41 years post-independence. And this is a problem which has been with us. Well, we know it was before that time, but here's a real live situation where that, in some cases, is still happening today. So some of the old problems are with us. And what we need to do is to let the younger generation know that they don't have to invent the wheel, but it's their responsibility to actually fix some of these problems, because we're not going to be able to fix them. We can only manage them. It's their job, really, to look at what is happening now and see how we're ultimately going to fix them.
Minister, some would say that we're not doing a very good job in managing the problem. You are the minister responsible for immigration, and you've had many of your predecessors who tried.
Yeah.
You can think about people like Mr. Roker and Mr. Maycock and Mr. Gibson, Mr. Pete, and the list goes on and on. And on the F&M side, Mr. Semenet and C.A. Smith and the rest of them. So there have been a number of ministers of immigration who have, I guess, tried to do something with the problem. Do we have the kinds of policies in place to deal effectively with the problem of illegal immigration in this country as well as legal immigration?
We're overwhelmed because we're underwhelmed with resources. Huge problem, very complex problem. But we just don't have the resources to be able to attack it in the way that we should. So we fight on many fronts to try and manage the issue. Now, one of the biggest things that's going to help us, I think, is these new boats, because enforcement has been a difficult issue. How do you track people down on the high seas? And how do you intercept them if you actually spot them on the high seas? I said the immigration force itself is only 231 officers for the country. So it depends on the defense force and the police and so on and so forth. And the other day we had a very interesting point. We were about to have a convention in Eleuthera. And I knew we had last done an interdiction exercise in Eleuthera in December of last year. A number of arrests and deportations, for example, at the Cove, 19 people were spotted working in uniforms without work permits. Most of them got away. 6 were captured. They pleaded guilty, paid the fines, and were deported. And there were a number of other deportations out of that exercise. After that, we had exhausted the vote, the money that's available to mount an exercise of that nature. So again, the problem begins to pile up. So I said to myself, now before going to Eleuthera, I'm not going to set foot in Eleuthera, because I hear, for example, in a place called Blackwood in North Eleuthera, that there is a confrontation of sorts between the Haitian community and the Bahamian community brewing. So I said, fine. The representative spoke to us and we said we'd try and organize some effort to do so. So we went over prior to my getting there. Have this exercise. It was interesting listening to people and their responses. First, they said that we went to the wrong places. Secondly, they said that, well, we took the people, but we let all of them go. Thirdly, they then started making allegations about the corruption of the officers. Fourthly, they said that, why did you take this one and not take the next one? Fifthly, they said, you only picked on the Haitians. What about the Americans? So it's a huge, huge problem. And I listen because it's my job to manage all the issues given the resources we have. And we try and tackle the problem. That's why I said I'm not going to pretend that it can be fixed. I think we only have the ability to manage it. And just when I was down in Antigua, I got a call from a contact up in the Abacos who said that two boats had launched off from the north of Haiti and were headed to Marsh Harbor. So we're trying to track that down, because one of the things we hear from our intelligence is that these boats are actually being driven by people using cell phones here in the Bahamas, telling them what to do, where to land, where to go. And the question I have for the public officials who are responsible for intelligence and enforcement is, why can't we interrupt that network? One of the things I think we can do is, on the Haitian end, and I believe President Martelly is now proposing to come to the Bahamas on the 29th with a delegation to try and deal with this, amongst other issues, to allow more diplomatic officers in Haiti so that we can get a handle on what is happening with this. And similarly, you know, there are migration talks going on right now with the Cubans. So we have a vast country, 100,000 square miles of water to police. And then we aren't all agreed on what we do with the ones who are here.
But Minister, we have some enclaves here in our country. They are called shanty towns. Many Bahamians know them as shanty towns. And on our radio programs, people complain that we must know where they are and who are the occupants. The Immigration Department must know where they are, and the assumption is that there are scores of illegal immigrants who are in these shanty towns.
Well, now, that's an interesting thing. You would think so. And I think we do, in fact, know, and there's the intelligence. But again, the enforcement section, I said 231 officers, the enforcement section of immigration is 12 officers in New Providence. Mm-hmm. And I can tell you,
assisted by defense,
yeah, defense and so forth. And that depends on when their resources are available. Because there's, just to go back to that Eleuthera thing, for example, we were asked to stand down the operation because at the detention center there was a backup, because there were something like 376 nationals of Haiti in the detention center. And what happened was there was a huge thunderstorm the week before, so the flights had to be canceled to Haiti. And so 100 people had been interdicted the day before, and so they were saying, look, you're going to make the facility unsafe if you actually go to Eleuthera and you do an interdiction in Eleuthera. But it seemed to me that it should go ahead. That should not dictate what happened. So, you know, the numbers are not there anymore. But right after that was done, there was a ship with 90 in the Exumas. And then you hear 100 in Cat Island, and then Long Island, there was another ship. So the numbers keep coming. The source is doesn't dry up. And that's what we have to tackle. Now, as far as the shanty towns are concerned, I think the shanty towns are there, but I think people would be surprised at the fact of two things. One is that very often, of course, Bahamians own the land, and these people are paying to be in these places, number one, so it's a town planning issue. And then secondly, many of them actually have work permits. Mm. So you go and you do an exercise, and you end up, let's say, letting all but 10%, you have to release them because it turns out they either have applications in or they actually have a work permit.
But if you get one or two who are here illegally, you would be doing your job.
No question, and that's done. But you know, as I say, it's resources, and the department does it every day, every week. I can tell you the new man who's in charge, he's stretched beyond his capacity. But every day, every week, for the resources
Mr. Mitchell,
we have.
Wasn't this a problem which was foisted on the Bahamian people Tell you why. On numerous occasions, when Wendell and I would talk to the late Paul Adley, and I remember asking Mr. Adley, when you all were at Marlborough House negotiating the independence constitution, was this matter raised? He said, yes. But he said the British told them that it was something that they had to deal with. So you knew from 40 years ago that this was going to be a problem.
Well, look, in 1972, when they were negotiating the independence constitution, I was a student in the UK. And I remember the Honorable Dalrymple. Now, Honorable Dalrymple was then Minister for Home Affairs. And he gave me a ride from the Dorchester Hotel, where he was staying, to the tube station. And we're sitting in the back of the taxi, and he says to me, you know, Fred, I think we've actually solved this problem of illegal migration. So I said, really, how is that? He says, well, the Constitution says, the new Constitution will say, that unless your parents are Bahamian, you can't be Bahamian. And I thought, great, fantastic idea. The problem is that prior to 1973, there was no such distinction. Anybody born in the Bahamas was Bahamian. So immediately after the 10th of July, 1973, that changed. So if your family was here and three children born before independence, they're Bahamians. Two children born after, they're not Bahamians. What did that do? The unintended consequence of that policy, which is now enshrined in the Constitution and which I dare say can't be changed, is that there is now a pileup of applications.
Backlog.
It's also created social discrimination. So it's fed this issue of us and them. And enormous problems, knock-on problems from it. So it hasn't really solved the problem.
You created a problem.
Exactly, a problem was created. But as I rather stated as an unintended consequence, because I think they believe that this was a way of tackling the issue.
I'll tell you another problem. A young Bahamian of Haitian extraction told me that, you know, there's law that you can apply for Bahamian citizenship when you're 18, right?
But before your 19th birthday.
Right. He said that for 18 years you tell him he's a Haitian. And then all of a sudden, when he gets to be 20 or 21, he's Bahamian. So what is he supposed to think?
Well,
you tell him he's a Bahamian and you treat him as a Haitian.
Yeah.
And then, you know, you give him citizenship. He said,
There's obviously a larger dialogue that has to go on with the community about this, but it's such an emotional topic, you can't have a rational conversation about it because people are divided right down the middle. And what I tell people, you know, is not, I'm not an activist, you know. I'm the minister, so I'm the guardian of the policy which actually exists, and I have to manage it as best I can. So you try and deal with the applications, you know, kids who stop you in the supermarket who've been here all their lives. And the thing is, most people are lost about all the regulations and the, you know, what you have to do and so on and so forth. So it is a problem. Now what's coming is this. We've had a problem trying to verify birth certificates. Mm-hmm. You know, people say, oh, I was born in the Bahamas. My parents took me to Haiti. And I came back at a certain time.
Yeah.
And, you know, the birth certificate doesn't have any biometric on it, so you don't actually know. You try and do things like make them go to the PMH, and so that the birth of the baby is matched up with the time on the birth certificate, and, you know, as a means of verifying. So what we're trying to say now is, and this, I think, unfortunately, only applies to the largest class of people this applies to, Haitians. The second class it applies to are Jamaicans to a lesser extent. And that is this. If you're an American citizen who's born in this country, your parents are Americans and you're born in this country, first thing they do is they run off to the U.S. Embassy, go get the passport of their country. The Haitians don't do that, by and large. They should, because they should have a proper identity document. And we just got confirmed in Antigua that no matter where in the world you're born, if your parents are Haitian, you're Haitian at birth without having to do any application of any kind. Unlike the situation with Jamaicans, where you have to apply for Jamaican citizenship. So if you don't, you don't get it. And so you have Jamaicans, for example, who are born in this situation in the Bahamas, who have neither recognized as by the Constitution of the Bahamas as Bahamian. The Jamaican Constitution says they're not Jamaican. So in this particular case, this small case, we think those persons are stateless. And we, you know, something is being done to address that application process, because the law says you can't have a stateless individual in your country. But what should happen is that any person who has foreign parents, they should go to their embassy, get their passport of their country, and get a residency certificate to be in the Bahamas. And so that's the discussion we're now having. And we think that what this will do is, when the person reaches 18, there'll then no longer be any question about identity, because the person will have a record with the Department of Immigration for being in the Bahamas.
Yes, but the Haitian national is not interested in that, Ms. Minister. You're the guardian of the people. You're there to ensure that the proper policies are in place. Obviously, we have a serious problem on our hands. Don't we need constitutional change in this particular instance?
Well, I think that if you look at my work as an activist, I've said, and just telling you how the policy developed, that I think that that's the way to deal with it, is if you could get constitutional reform. But the fact is, as a practical matter, that's not going to happen. It's not going to happen.
You don't think so?
No, it's not going to happen. The society is divided, intractably so. The sides, the lines are drawn. You can't have a rational conversation of any kind on it without people descending into a shouting match and, you know, who is more patriotic and who's unpatriotic.
Because there's a phobia, isn't it?
Some people do have a phobia, but, you know, some people also have a legitimate belief that the Bahamas should remain the way it is. Notwithstanding the evidence, of course, that migration is a natural state of man, and it does help a country because it strengthens a country at the end of the day.
But governments are supposed to get in these issues and these thorny issues and sort them out, and so that we can have orderly development. Successive governments have not been minded to do that.
Yes, but you know how these issues are. There are a couple of issues. Death penalty, Haitian nationals, LGBT. You mentioned those words around here, people go ballistic, you know. And, you know, you are, you know, if you start talking about immigration reform, want to help the Haitians and you trying to destroy the country and you're unpatriotic and it's just a shouting match. So in terms of a lot of the policies, just looking at, and I think this is Caribbean-wide, I think that governments have to manage these problems. I'm not saying in secret, I think, but you just have to proceed to do it in the regulatory fashion that does not require going to Parliament or making some proclamation or change in the regulations.
But you should educate your people and bring them along, right?
You should, no question. I think that's why I'm saying we're going to have launch a discussion with the leadership of the Haitian community, because what we found out, and I think this was to our detriment in 2007, is the FNM decided that the Haitian community was key to whether you won or lost a general election in this country. And they went after that demographic to our peril. And I think we rediscovered that fact in 2012. And so it is finely balanced the way one has to approach it. And so there's no other choice but to actually manage the issues.
Okay, Godfrey has a question for you, but we have to take a break. And we will come right back. Fred Mitchell, our guest on the program today, is the Minister of Foreign Affairs and Immigration, and there are many issues we can speak to him about today. But we'll come right back.